Not Your Mother's Radio is listener funded. If you wish to assist and help keep the station active, funds can be sent via PayPal to Elliot. Is not your mother at gmail.com. Remember, there is one L in Elliot. Thank you for your assistance. It is appreciated.
Greetings all, this is a very interesting episode of Not Your Mother's Radio. On August 31, 2020, Elliot spent the evening talking with original Mothers of Invention alumni, Bunk Gardner. Discussions ran from Frank Zappa to the state of the world as they saw it in real time. So let's listen into two friends who are troubled and hoping that things get better very soon. Enjoy the show and please remember to stay informed.
Hi, Elliot.
Hey, how you doing, Bunk?
Okay, how are you doing?
Good, everybody doing good, everybody safe and feeling good?
Well, for the time being, yes.
Yeah, for the time being.
Yeah.
I'm ready to get started, whenever you are, and it's going to be a little different tonight. We're not going to do too much music, if any, and we're going to talk about just pretty much the mess things are in, right?
Well, whatever you'd like to get into, and you know, I mean, being home so much it hasn't been easy for me, and actually Don called this morning and trying to figure out if we could find a tennis court that was kind of in between from where he lives and me, and at least, you know, get a little exercise in or something, because where he's living, you know, they have a swimming pool, but they've closed it off, and we both like to play tennis, so it would be nice to be able to get into even a foursome or whatever.
So you've been locked in the house, right?
Well, I do a lot of cooking, and so I actually go out and shop a lot, but I'm very close to a couple of Whole Foods and a few others, and you know, Avon's and whatever. So I don't have to go far, you know, to do some shopping, I'm a food addict, I guess, to a certain degree, especially with having a community garden about 5 minutes from my house. So, but I think I'm a little obsessed in some ways, Elliot, about eating good and trying to get as much organic, you know, stuff as possible. I hate to have to get in, and everything I buy you have to rinse and wash or, you know, whatever. But you
know, I know.
But I know. So it's just something more that you have to deal with.
Yeah, I haven't been out of my house in 5 months.
You're kidding?
Nope. They won't let me out of the house. I guess I'm high risk, you know, according to my doctor, but
of course. But you're a baby. How old are you?
I'm 64, but I had when I was 58, I had 2 heart attacks in 8 days.
Wow.
So they kind of it's all genetics, you know, it's congestive heart failure, so they figured don't push the envelope. So I'm pretty lucky. My wife goes out, she does the shopping, but I'm not that lucky because she cooks. So I'm just fooling, she's a good cook, but so that's and now it's even crazier because I have my 2 grandkids living with us, and one's in second grade and one just started middle school, so now we're kind of helping them get through, you know, they're being you know, the schools are closed, so everything's done online now, and it's a nightmare trying to get them,
yeah, yeah.
To, you know, to get them through a day. That, you know, they have a lot of energy. They don't.
I know.
You know, they don't want to sit in front of a computer all day.
Yeah. No. There's got to find ways to get some of that energy, regardless. And my daughter found about I think five other mothers. Because their school is not in session.
Right.
So my daughter found a mother, five other mothers, and they went in together financially, and they go to a house, and from 8 to 2, they get all the basic, you know, things, and actually it's also the teacher is French, so they learn a foreign language at the same time of whatever you know, curriculum they have to cover.
Yeah.
And actually they have a pool in the backyard, so you know, after class they can jump in there, but they need some form of exercise to get rid of all that excess energy.
Well, what we do is we have a German Shepherd, a little, you know, young one.
Uh-huh.
And so we take him for a 2-3 mile walk every day.
Oh, good.
Yeah, and, you know, the kids, you know, I make sure the kids come with us, you know, come with me. And so I get, you know, it's not like I'm stuck in the house. You know, I do take that walk every day.
Yeah.
But I haven't been, you know, to a store or anything like that in months.
Wow.
So you know, we get the dog out. We kind of, spend time with him. You know, we run him. We play with him. We just burn off his energy, too. So the kids.
And how old is the German Shepherd?
2.5.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
we had a German Shepherd for a while, and something starts to happen on their back legs, some kind of I forget what it was, but
right.
You know, eventually he couldn't actually, you know, get up and walk, and
yeah.
I'm telling you, Elliot, you know, that last scene, you know, at the you know, the at the vet's place. It was hard to deal with it.
I know.
And my daughter also had another dog. We went through the same thing, and I said, never again. You know, I mean, it's like losing one of your kids.
I know. And we had one that passed a week before we got this guy, who wasn't a Shepherd. She was a little white. We found her. You know, she was a rescue. He's a rescue too, actually. And you know, it's hard. You know, she had heart failure, and then, you know, she, you know, we had a oxygen tent in the house for her and everything. And
you know,
so you do what you can. Yeah, and they are like kids. But
I know.
Who said that it's you know, it's a good thing that they only live 10, 15 years? Can you imagine having them for 25 years and then losing them?
It's tough.
Yeah, it is. So,
and besides that, Elliot, I mean, some of the bills that we went through is just like going to your doctor. I mean, it was incredible.
I know, it's worse because there's really no insurance.
Yeah.
Now I think there is. We're looking into it now while he's still healthy. Yeah, mm-hmm. I know. I mean, it was like $700 a day for the other one's hospital care.
Wow.
And you know, it is, they bleed you. They knew she wasn't going to make it, but they still talk you into doing it, you know?
I know.
Because it's a business, and, you know.
I know.
And it's really not fair to anybody involved.
Yeah.
But
yeah. Well, and the same thing with the last dog. They said, you know, we can operate, but there's no guarantee about the quality of life or whatever. You know, and we're talking $8,000-$9,000. So we decided, you know, not to have to go through that.
I know it's hard.
You know, that kind of stuff sticks with you for quite a while.
Yeah, it does.
And I easily get emotional sometimes about things like that. And and again, I still remember, you know, that heartache and have to go through with my daughter and her son. So it's tough.
No, it is. So what are we going to do about the scene of things out there? It's crazy, huh?
Yeah. No, it's really. Well, you know what? Actually, because it's been so hot here, and I'm sure it has been there.
Oh yeah.
For you know, a week or so, you know, we ended up going to Malibu, you know, to the beach for the day, and really, it wasn't that crowded, depending on what part of the beach you were.
Sure.
But you know, it just felt good to, you know, dive in the water, you know, a few minutes, swim around and come back out. But
yeah.
You know, the same routine of just staying in Elliott, it's just you know, it's not easy to deal with when you're used to you know, just leaving the house and doing whatever you know, take care of business. But that kind of thing is, it's so easy to get caught up in paying bills and taking care of, you know, you know, the everyday stuff.
Right.
I honestly don't get a chance to listen to much music lately, which, you know, for a while, I would normally, you know, on a fairly daily basis, listen to something. So,
what do you listen to normally? What's a day's music for you?
I have an incredibly large classical section, and I've got a large jazz section and avant-garde, and it kind of depends. But you know, Elliot, I grew up having to, you know, in the 40s and the 50s, whatever, having to learn all the melodies from all the shows, you know.
Right.
You know, Cole Porter, Irving Berlin, you name it.
Yeah.
And to play a job, you had to know all those songs.
Sure.
So I listened to a couple of piano players. Well, you know, Oscar Peterson, but I'm a very big Bill Evans fan.
Okay.
And you know, when you know a song, Elliot, and you can play it on piano, and you know the changes in the whole harmonic structure.
Uh-huh.
When you hear somebody play something, and you say, "Oh, you know, all the inner voices," and it's. And I've said this before to Bonnie, you know, on my deathbed, you know, just play Bill Evans one tune after another, because most of the songs I know.
Right.
And it's just a revelation to hear him play of the songs.
Were you a Miles Davis fan?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Because the other day I spoke to Sam Morrison. You know, Sam, the sax player, he took over for... Fortune, when Fortune left the Miles, he took over. And a few weeks ago, I spoke to Harvey Goldberg, who played bass on Bitches Brew.
Yeah.
And and Lenny White is an old friend of mine. He, you know, he was like 17, 18 when he got into when he worked with Miles. And I'm a big jazz fan too. And
well, living in the Village in New York, you know, in the mid '60s, I can't tell you how great it was. And we lived about 50 feet from the Village. Is it the Village Vanguard?
Yeah, Village Vanguard, sure.
And of course, it was run by the mafia.
Yeah.
But every Monday night they had Latin night, and I played Latin music for years, and some of the, you know, Tito Rodriguez, Tito you know, Tito
sure.
Puente, you name it.
Yeah.
And to hear some of those great bands, and I also heard Miles Davis and Dizzy Gillespie on the same bill there.
Wow.
I mean, you know, to be in that kind of environment was just truly incredible.
Really,
You know, and we were playing seven nights a week, two shows a night at a theater right by the Village Vanguard. So
yeah, was that the Garrick?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. And you know, who used to hang out in those clubs? Bill Graham.
Yes. Yeah, crazy Bill Graham.
Crazy Bill Graham. In fact, I was talking to a documentary, a film guy, a week or two ago, and he said he's doing a film on Latin music now, and somebody gave him all of these still photos, and there was Bill Graham, you know, dancing in them, you know. They said Bill used to hang out in the clubs all the time. You know, I'm pretty friendly with the Santana guys. from way back when to the new Santana band. Mm-hmm. And Bill Graham's the guy who got him to do Oye Como Va. He's the one who talked them into it. And,
wow.
Yeah, so...
And, you know, in the early days, it seemed like every other week we would fly up to San Francisco and play there. I mean, we were regulars. And again, what an exciting... and normally, most of the time, and I probably still have some of the posters, it was like minimum two bands and usually three bands.
Yes.
You know, on the weekend, and wow, that was got to meet a lot of other musicians there.
Bill used to get these eclectic lineups. He just, you know, he would throw anybody in, you know, in the pot. You know, I used to go to the Fillmore East a lot, and I ran a nightclub on Long Island, and it was called My Father's Place, and I don't know if you remember that. It was like the Bottom Line. It was this Bottom Line sister club, pretty much. And we would do, like, just, you know, eclectic things like that. We would have, you know, James Brown with NRBQ or something like that, you know. And we did it for another reason. We just took whoever was around to book, you know.
And
it worked out great. But
But
Bill Graham had a knack for that. And you guys had a problem with, well, I don't know about you, but Frank had a problem with the Velvet Underground, right? I know you guys worked with the Velvet Underground for a
while. We did. But, you know, one of the reasons we moved to New York was that there was so much work there, and we could take a bus and not have to go too far. So that was certainly... one of the big reasons we got to work, you know, up and down the state and other places quite a while. So that was really great.
Yeah, I was born in Brooklyn. I was raised pretty much in Queens and Long Island, but I was born in Brooklyn. So I spent a lot of, you know, my whole life in New York, really, up to about, 10 years ago. I did a lot of traveling. I used to manage... amphitheaters and clubs and stadiums and things, and then I was sent down on the road to kind of patch up the ones in trouble. So I did a lot of traveling, but my home base was, you know, one spot. It was in New York for a good part of it, and then when I got to New Mexico, I kind of stayed here for a while. And you know, it was great, but you know, I spent, you know, I'd say about 3, maybe 4 years bouncing around. You guys did it for decades. It must have wore you guys, you know, it must have worn you out. It's not easy.
But I remember in the mid-60s, Elliot, there were places at night they said, you know, some areas that don't go there because of the gangs and a lot of stuff going on. And, you know, I know my brother went to school for a while, but there were what a wealth of clubs and live music.
Incredible.
That was, oh, absolutely, absolutely.
Incredible. And also, New York, you could get anything you want any time of day.
Yeah.
Nothing closed. And if it did, there's always one place underground that everybody knew. You wanted sushi 2 o'clock in the morning, there was somebody to do it for you, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And well, I don't think anybody slept. You know, it was always getting to bed at 5 or 6 in the morning.
Yep.
To a certain extent, living with somebody below, above, or on either side, after a while, for me, Elliot, wasn't that easy to deal with, because again, you know, you get back to your place like
I know,
2, 3, 4 in the morning.
And with any luck, you're not alone.
Yes. Well, and finding a place sometimes when your lease ran out or whatever, that was another nightmare. And maybe I told you, originally we lived right on the corner from the Garrick Theater, but on the bottom floor was an Italian social club. So they checked everybody that, you know, went up.
Sure.
And maybe I told you, you know, the owner said, Johnny, if you have any problems with anybody, let us know and we'll lean on them. So they really took care of business.
Yeah, they did. Yeah, they did. I knew a lot of those guys, too, you know, from being in the nightclub business.
Yeah.
It was always a good idea to stay friendly with them.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah, so New York's great. I miss New York. It's just... you know, it's not what it used to be. You know, obviously now nothing is what it used to be. But New York itself, you know, a lot of the clubs closed down. A lot of the venues aren't there anymore.
Yes.
And, you know, like everything else, it kind of became, you know, like Vegas, like Disneyland for grown-ups, you know, that kind of thing. So it did lose a lot of its magic. You still have Broadway in New York, which is great when it's opened. And I was managing, you know, the Meadowlands, you know, Giant Stadium. You know, that was okay, but, you know, I wasn't a big sports guy, but when the bands came in, it was cool. You know, the Rolling Stones would come in for a week, you know, Springsteen would do a week.
Yeah.
So that was pretty cool. But I saw the Mothers at the Fillmore, on 68 or 69.
Mm-hmm.
And then they came through again, but you were gone. Mark and Howard were in the 70s.
Yeah, I actually didn't consider that a really, really great musical band.
You know,
there was just something there that maybe they were funny, but
there was a lot missing in that band, and I know Mark and Howard. I did the company I worked for did a reggae album with them, and so I spent some time with them, and they definitely have a set of pipes on them, but when they were with the Mothers, it wasn't really I don't think Jim Ponce belonged in that band. He wasn't a great bass player.
No, not at all.
You know, it was just, it was a comedy act. It was kind of like a Jerry Lewis act that went out on the road and sang. There really was an impressive band. I actually liked the Flo and Eddie band when they left Zappa a little better because they were doing more music. They weren't doing, so much of the crazy stuff.
Yes.
They still had some of the key members, in the band.
Yeah. And I forget which one, Howard. They had a TV show.
Yeah.
I forget what it was.
Yep. On Channel 5. WNEW? What was it? Well, I know. It was on Channel 5.
And it was a kid's show. It was a kid's show.
Oh, Strawberry Shortcake.
Yes.
Strawberry Shortcake.
I know I did a lot of work playing flute and soprano and whatever for them on that show.
Yeah.
So they were pretty successful in more ways than one when I think of it. It's so much more so than us.
You remember Channel 5 in New York, one of the independent stations?
Uh-huh.
Anyway, they did a show, Flo and Eddie had a TV show. And it wasn't the greatest show. It lasted a couple of weeks. And then they got involved with radio. They were doing... I think they were on right after Howard Stern.
Uh-huh.
And he hated them. He would scream and carry on when they got into the room. He was, for some reason. But, but they tended to land on their feet a lot of the time. The Mothers of Invention, there was no Mothers of Invention after you guys left. Became the Mothers, and then it became Frank Zappa. You guys were the Mothers of Invention. And I'm actually talking to Ian this week.
Yeah, you mentioned something.
Yeah. And, he was a great guy, talented guy, too. I just don't know what to talk to him about, but I'll figure it out when I talk to him. He's very laid back.
Something, when he first got there, honestly, Elliot, he was, how can I put it? He was so square in terms of, and he wanted to fit in so bad. And when he saw how crazy we were, You know, it was like he tried to ingratiate himself with Frank so much, and in fact, I would make a joke of do you know what the difference between an ass kisser and a brown nose is? And the answer is depth perception. And Ian was right there, Frank made a lot of promises to him about, you know, I'm going to feature you on the blah, 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 blah.
Right.
But honestly, Elliot, the way Frank treated Roy and Jimmy in the early days went so much against my grain that I said to myself, I don't think I'm ever going to be able to be friends with Frank.
Right.
Because there were things that he did, and he would make fun of Roy and Jim, and especially Roy, and you know, because Roy quit the band at least two or three times, if not more.
Really.
And well, you know, there was a thing about him being a Mexican,
right?
And his, you know, his value of self-worth, Elliot, was not good, and again there were, you know, you have problems in any band like that, but Frank would threaten them, you know, like, because sometimes in the early days Jimmy could play trumpet,
right,
and he wanted to have somebody else come in play drums and Jimmy be on the front. Anyhow, you know, he kept, you know, wanting Jimmy to go in the bathroom and practice and making fun of him. And, you know, there were, again, that kind of things bothered me.
Yeah.
But, you know, we all realized that he got so much laughter and humor from all of us that we realized early on that was part of our duty to make sure he didn't get too serious about things, because, you know, if there was a mistake, Elliot, he could just go on and on.
Yeah.
And looking at the negative and, threatening everybody to have to re-audition, you know, to stay in the band.
Yeah. Well, that's anyway. Really sad, because that band was, it was such a great unit, you know?
Yeah.
It really was. I was checking out some videos just the other day. It was King Kong in Europe. I forgot, it might have been Germany.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, it kind of, you were like the centerpiece. You were the main character in that, and it was incredible. I mean, you know, you were doing the wah-wah thing, you know, way before anybody else, you know, in rock anyway was doing it. You know.
Yeah. Well, I had my bassoon hooked up too to a wah-wah, and I remember early on some nights Frank had a thing where he would jump up in the air.
Yeah.
And when he came back down, he expected us to know what new song we were going to go to.
Right.
And a lot of times we that really creates magic. We kind of knew, you have really magical nights sometimes musically when that kind of stuff happens. And I know Frank talked about everybody getting some kind of a helmet where he could, you know, he could communicate, it wasn't that far-fetched.
No.
But I understand where Frank was coming from. I just think, Elliot, that when you're consumed about perfection, you leave out the whole, you know, human element that sometimes is, I think, necessary to let it breathe.
Yes.
So,
and he had no friends, right? That they said he had very few friends.
Yeah.
That you know, he was pretty much a loner, and
he didn't really know how to communicate with people other than, you know, through music. And that's really sad, too.
Yeah.
And, you know,
and I'm sure that a lot of times in the early days, everybody in the band was getting laid except him.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that, you know, that created just a little problem there.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Well, it was so much fun for the band.
Yeah. But that's, you know what, back in those days, that's what a band was. You know, when he got rid of, after his accident, when the Mothers left him, he kind of went, for lack of a bit of term, corporate, you know? He had he had a business band. That's what it became, you know?
Yeah.
It was hired guns. There was no warmth to the bands. I mean, he had some great players, and, you know,
no doubt.
He had some killer players.
And I remember saying to Jimmy and Motorhead, whatever, that because in the early days, even in our off days, we were rehearsing and practicing, and I said, some of the new bands, I don't know how much he paid, but he had to pay them to rehearse.
Yes.
And I said, just on that alone, my God, so much money we would have made.
Yeah.
But, you know, again, just an afterthought.
But there was something going on about the SAG union. Somebody was telling me that he used to rehearse within a 30-mile radius of where the SAG building was, so that he wouldn't have to pay overtime.
Oh, well, that wouldn't surprise me at all. Because, Lumpy Gravy was one of the few sessions at Capitol Records that had to go through the union that I was on.
Yeah, yeah.
But he tried to avoid every time, you know. I think Absolutely Free might have been the only album, plus Lumpy Gravy, that he went through the union. Every other thing, and it kind of bothers me because I could have really got at least a decent pension.
That's what all the guys are saying. Nobody got pensions because he knew how to skirt the system.
Yeah, 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 yeah. And Frank always had grandiose plans, you know, to bring in all these other people sometimes in recording things. And, you know, that cost a lot of money.
Sure.
And I remember Reuben and the Jets. I got $500 for it.
Really?
And also part of that recording was Uncle Meat.
Yeah, yeah.
So he wasn't very liberal in terms of, you know, his manager. He would say, you know, keep track of, you know, all the hours you're doing. And Elliot, once you get past, you know, a couple of hundred hours, you know, it's like, well, you know, I realized that I wasn't going to get any money worth talking about.
Right.
And Frank could live in the recording studio, and I mean that.
Yes.
He could go from anywhere from 8, you know, to 17, 18 hours, you know, with the coffee and cigarettes and just play with all the knobs and do all this recording that was, he was unstoppable, you know, most of the time.
Well, then he hired somebody in the band to rehearse half a day before he got there.
Yeah, yeah.
You guys, you know, he was there with you, right, the whole time when you were rehearsing. But what do you call him, the clone meister? Somebody, and that clone meister always got beat up by the other guys in the band. They hated whoever was doing the clone meister job.
I know. Well, you know, some guys get this power issue, and you know, the regulars said, "Oh, fuck you," you know. But you know, at the same time, I just remember on the road meeting a lot of other guys in other bands that had hits out there, Elliot.
Yeah.
But they were starving.
Yeah.
You know, so it was either the record company, the manager, somebody down the line.
Yep.
And actually, we never realized that Herbie's brother is the one that drew up the contract for the
right.
for the Mothers, which is a little conflict of interest. But
yeah.
you know,
yep. Also, Herbie had a rotten reputation.
Yeah.
You know, he dealt with who Lenny Bruce was his artist.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Zero Mostel, I believe, he had on the contract.
He had a whole, Tim Buckley.
Tim Buckley, Alice Cooper,
yes.
yeah.
Yes.
Now,
yes.
I understand Ian Underwood produced the first Alice Cooper album without getting credit for that.
Well, all I remember is that when Herbie first signed Alice Cooper, Elliot, musically, and this is maybe even an understatement, they were terrible. They were terrible.
Yeah.
It was only when they started putting makeup on in the theater of the absurd did they actually start to get, you know, some recognition.
Right,
but, you know,
right.
even saying that, I don't know if I told you this before, but we played a festival in Florida at, I think it might have been Hialeah racetrack.
Yep, in Miami, yep.
Yes, and it was a total failure.
Yeah, Jimi Hendrix played there too, right?
Yes, well, I remember we were playing and Jimi Hendrix came in on helicopter and whatever. Anyhow, after the concert, Herbie went, you know, to collect the money for the band, and the promoter said, no, we lost money, you're not going to get anything. And Herbie said, oh no. So when he was there, he made a phone call to Mickey Cohn, who was...
Oh, I know Mickey. Yeah, I know.
Okay. He was the head man out here.
Yeah.
And he let him put on the phone, and don't you know it, within, you know, a few minutes later, we got our money. So, again, that shows you, the force of the mafia
right.
when somebody says you're not going to get paid, but we'll never forget that one.
Yeah. Wow, that's really, Mickey Cohn, wow. Yeah, so Herb knew the right people.
I guess so.
You personally, how many years have you been out on the road? You had to be out there for decades.
Well, in and out, but other than, you know, I toured with other artists, but
yeah.
Honestly, Elliot, I'm not a big fan of the road and, you know, living in hotels and whatever. And even when I was traveling with Don, because he was my roommate a lot of time,
yes.
you know, we would bring a blender, you know, we make smoothies. I mean, we made sure that we ate good
uh-huh.
and, you know, finding vegetarian restaurants, you know, I
cool.
mean, for me, that was the only way to survive because, you know, I can remember many times late at night going to a restaurant and whatever I saw on the menu, I said,
yeah.
I'll pass.
Yeah.
I'll wait till tomorrow, man. I'm not going to eat that.
Yeah, yeah.
So, there's a lot of instances there where it just depends on, how much you value your health.
Are you a vegetarian now?
Well, not really.
Okay.
But we eat probably more fish and whatever than anything. But a little turkey, a little chicken, and very, very little, and maybe if meat, lamb.
Right.
But again, we always it's usually a protein with vegetables.
Cool.
And basically that's it. And I went to culinary school for a couple of years in the 90s, and really it was that was a trip for me too. Getting to, you know, each week there would be a chef, you know, coming in and talking about how if you're working for a top chef, how you have to steal with your eyes, because some of the recipes, you know, nobody knew. You know, there were secret ingredients or whatever,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah, yeah.
And stories about some of the alcoholism in some of the chefs and what was going on. And, you know, that was a thing in itself. And I remember when I first started school that the number two business in going out of business was restaurants.
Sure, still, yeah.
Yeah, and yeah. But I ended up being a chef in Laguna Beach for a year or so. So,
oh, well, cool.
That was interesting.
Yeah, my brother's a chef, and he's a chef, and it's a tough business. He lost a couple of restaurants along the way. You know, you always wind up working with somebody else, and you know,
Nellie, you have to be married to the job.
Yeah,
listen,
you were married to your job. I was married to my job. You know, you're a musician. You have to be married to that job.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, I was running stadiums and arenas and stuff, and you know, and the whole thing is, you know, you work when people are playing, you know, and it's a lonely life. I mean, I'm married a little longer than you. I got married in 76, and you know, married to the same woman, and you know, we were doing fine and all that fun stuff, and we've been through ups and downs and everything else like every other couple, but we gave up a lot with me being in the entertainment business, you know?
Yeah.
You have no social life, really, because, you know, you're never around.
Yeah, well, actually, I think we got married in 76, too.
Oh, did you? So, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
So, well, yeah. So we're at the same, you know, we're in the same, you know, time frame in that.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
You know, but, you know, so you have no social life because I was never home.
Yeah.
And, you know, my kids, you know, my wife wound up, you know, raising my kids pretty much. You know,
yeah.
I would come home and, you know, spoil them because I didn't see them all week. And, you know, so, you know, the spirits get even with me. Now I'm raising my grandkids.
Yeah. But you know, Elliot, that's a recipe for a bad marriage.
Yeah.
For sure.
It is.
When you're out on the road all the time.
Yeah.
And again, any place you play, if somebody wants to take your hand, get you high, whatever. And again, it has to be pretty difficult to stay married and be away that long in many ways. So to survive that, it takes you know, it takes a lot of commitment and you know, a lot of give and take there, man.
Yeah. And you know, but we're fine. It's just you know, I think at this point we're you know, we're kind of like, you know, we're each other's best friends, obviously, which you're supposed to be when you're married. But I became pretty much a loner in the whole thing because I was working all the time.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
so I have very few people that I can actually call friends. I have a lot of acquaintances, a lot of people who, you know,
yeah.
I could call and, you know, bullshit to and all that fun stuff.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
You know, I'm living in New Mexico now because it didn't matter where I wound up. I really didn't know anybody other than, you know, these acquaintances. So we kind of stayed here. My family, you know, is around us, and my son and my daughter live out here now too. So,
well, yeah, I think it really comes down to basically family and friends.
Yeah.
And again, friends really, you know, you have a few that you really call your friends.
Right.
And you know, the rest I would put in, you know, the acquaintance, you know,
sure.
I've met and we've done a few things and whatever.
Yeah.
And maybe it gets harder as the older you get. And I probably mentioned this before that I realized when Don and I would go out on the road, you know, somebody always would come up after the job and hand me their card if you hear of anything. And I never realized how much network is necessary in the music business to continue to work.
Yeah. Right.
And I was so far removed from that.
Yeah.
But at the same time, Elliot, I'm so happy I grew up when I did and went through, you know, and I still call it, you know, the good old days.
Yeah.
I have mentioned this before, too. I don't see a great future for artists in general.
No.
In this country. And you know, all of our work, for the most part, has always been in Europe. We would go every year, maybe twice a year. And the culture itself and how people receive you and take care of you is so much the opposite of what you get here in the United States. And I can't tell you how many, especially minorities, blacks, wanted to go and end up living in Europe because of the treatment they got.
Sure.
In more ways than
one. Most of the jazz guys wound up in France.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Well, and a few of them in the Scandinavian countries,
too. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, well, we don't treat our minorities, we never did, and in the foreseeable future, we're not going to treat them any better than we have.
Yes. Oh, I was just going to add, yes, it hasn't gotten any better, and I expressed, I think, before, of my culture shock going down south and seeing how they treated the blacks, but it's still... you know, I think of George Wallace, man. They were so against integration.
Yep.
And totally against blacks, and it's still right out there in front in so many ways. And this, the good old boy system is really still, you know, at the head of the controls.
Yeah.
In some way. And really, Elliot, it's like women are on the outside too.
And how about Jewish people?
Okay, yeah.
Now I'm Jewish, and I'll be honest with you. It's sometimes I think you may be better off being black, and I'll tell you why. I mean, if you're black, people know you're black. It's nothing that you're hiding. I think when people find out you're Jewish, they think you're trying to pull one over on them and not tell them.
Absolutely. And, you know, Bonnie being Jewish,
yes.
She's right out there.
Uh-huh.
And you're totally correct in that kind of discrimination.
Yeah.
That I didn't realize it before, but that's only because I didn't see it in traveling in the South and, you know, the whole thing about, you know, against blacks. But you know, and some of the magazines I read, there's a lot of people out there that are against the Chinese and Asians in general. So you know, it never stops.
Never stops. I mean, they'll go as far as Catholic, and you know, and then I can't figure out. It's the same Savior. You know, it's the same guy that you guys pray to, but Baptists and Catholics don't get along.
Well, Elliot, I made my first communion, you know, and I didn't go to a Catholic school, fortunately, but I remember talking to some of the, and this is the early 50s, the altar boys getting molested, you know, from the priest, that was going on full bore then, and maybe I told you this. One of my teaching jobs was at an Episcopalian school in Orange County, and when I got there, the pastor had just been convicted of drugging and molesting some of his students.
Jeez.
And one of the parents I was teaching, he had two boys. I taught one of them played saxophone, one of them played clarinet. He hired a private investigator to find out that this pastor had been convicted in Illinois, and all they did was send him out here.
Yeah.
So, you know what? That just reminds me of the whole Catholic thing where, you know, they find out somebody's in and they just ship him to another area.
Yeah.
And being held accountable. Well, man, we could go on.
Yeah, we can. Well, now, you see, now it's different now because, you know, my wife and I are Jewish. My kids, you know, my son and daughter are, but They each married, my daughter married a Mexican native person, and my daughter-in-law, my son, married a woman who's Native American and whatever. So my daughter adopted two kids, so two of my grandkids are adopted, and the ones that live with me are my son's kids, natural kids. But when you before this pandemic thing, when you came to my house on a Sunday, it looked like the United Nations. I have one Caucasian grandson, and they get darker as they get taller.
Uh-huh.
And people are going to have to realize this is going to be the way it is. This is going to be life. You know, these old, you know, these white guys who are running the show now are going to have to give it up.
Well, it's going to be hard because they are making it so difficult for any immigrant coming in this country.
Yeah.
They want them to be able to speak English, have a job referral, and all this whole line of crap that just defies what this country stands for, at least in the early days.
Right.
But I don't want to get started on this, the whole administration done.
But that's what it is. This administration is it's a fascist regime. You know,
yes.
It really is. And it's not only the immigrants that are coming in. It's the minorities that are here already that are getting screwed.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, even if we don't let anybody else in, which, you know, that's...
Well, they don't want, you know, all the kids that were that born here.
Yeah.
You know, the DACA, whatever.
DACA's, yep.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, they just want to push them out of the way and possibly deport all of them.
Yeah.
And I've never seen an administration that is so anti-immigrant.
No.
And just against just about anything other than scamming people. And, you know, that when I say that, you know, Steve Bannon just being indicted, you know, there's been so many people put in jail from this administration that it blows your mind.
Well, there's a new book coming out tomorrow. It's called Trump versus the USA, I think, by a guy named Michael Snyder.
Well, I know. In fact, I heard some of the dialogue from it.
Yeah, yeah.
And some of the stuff that they've been trying to do is like somebody had to be there and say, hey, you can't do that. It's illegal. But they're certainly trying on a daily basis to skirt the law.
And what scares me, if you know about this, what don't you know? What aren't they telling us?
Yeah. Well, there's been so many books, and even Michael Cohen's hasn't come out yet.
Yeah.
But, you know, they all, you know, it's a hoax. All these people have some kind of a grudge. But, I mean, there is so much shit on Trump that I don't know if you're, an old friend of mine said, you know, there's a lot of people out there that have cornered the market on stupidity.
Yeah.
But some people don't want to accept any of those facts. And it, again, reminds me of a religious fanatics.
Yeah, I don't think they don't want to accept the facts. I don't think they care.
Oh, absolutely not. But it's that fanaticism that comes in religion and in politics some way. And we have a couple of friends, and Bonnie, after a couple of drinks, look out, that we can't talk about that stuff because, you know, you can't have any reasonable dialogue with somebody that won't accept any of the facts or any truth to a lot of things. So that makes it hard. And actually, when we go out, my daughter says to Bonnie, don't drink too much, because once she gets out there, don't stop right now.
Well, you know what scares me? Let's say we get to the election and he loses, which we're all hoping for.
Yes.
What's going to happen from that time frame from the election to the inauguration? That's the time that scares me more than anything.
Well, that's true, but man, there are so many charges against him that's going, I hope, put him in jail for a long time, But yes, they've expressed that concern quite a few times because, according to Trump, you know, everything is rigged.
Yeah.
And, you know, they're all out to get him. So, you know, that remains to be seen. But honestly, Elliot, I hope that it's going to be a landslide
victory.
I do too. I don't want it to be close, you know.
No.
I just hope people realize, and especially down south with the blacks, that they can get out and actually vote, because they've been taking places to vote away in so many places.
Yeah.
That it's so apparent that they and then gerrymandering, you know, so many of these places where it makes it so difficult.
Yep.
You know, you have to show up with your driver's license or identification and everything. Anyhow, they're making it hard. So
no, they are, and the LGBTQ faction has to get out there, and every minority has to get out there. There's no reason not to vote this year. This year is probably more dangerous. And you know, it's not funny, but we thought that George Bush was a terror.
Yeah.
I mean,
I agree. I agree. Yes.
Yeah, we thought that Bush was the worst thing that ever happened to us.
Yes.
And then this guy popped up. God knows what's waiting in the wings.
Yes.
You know?
Well, you know, and again, I totally agree about the Bush thing, but there are so many conspiracy theories, this QAnon and all these other things that don't make any sense
at all. No.
I mean, it's for me, it's like Nazis coming out of the woodwork.
Yeah, they're out.
Totally.
Yep.
They are. That is a truly scary part. That is just. I don't know how it got started, but you know, it's out there now. And in Charlottesville, you know, these guys carrying these things and talking about, you know, let's kill the Jews. And I mean, it's just God, scary.
Yeah. And I'm not worried about me. I'm an old guy already, but I got grandkids. They don't deserve this crap. You know, they're separated by two more generations after me, and they're the ones that are gonna get penalized for this.
Yeah. It's hard to be optimistic.
Yeah.
In more ways than one.
Yeah, it is.
And I never used to be an activist politically or whatever, but you know what? You have to start at the community level.
Mm-hmm.
Where you start organizing in your neighborhood and make sure that whoever is getting elected, that they're going to have to come back and report to, you know, and some kind of transparency on what is going on. Otherwise, every other day, you know, somebody politically is being indicted for some kind of fraud or whatever, and that is becoming, you know, like an everyday thing.
And he's pardoning them all.
Yeah.
So he's just releasing them back out to the wild, so to speak, you know?
But he's got this thing where if you get in trouble, you know, he'll pardon them.
Yes.
Which, you know, again, at this point, is so right out in front. Just like he said, if I shoot somebody on Fifth Avenue, I'm not in trouble, you know?
No. Yep.
So it's blatant now.
Yeah, and his kids are more dangerous than he is.
Yes. Yes,
his daughter and his son—they're on the fringe of lunacy.
Yeah, well, his sister, who just retired as a judge, had all these recordings that the niece made, saying that he has no principles, he's a moron.
Yep.
He's in it for himself. And all this thing, but you know, people don't believe that.
No.
They don't want to believe it. So
even if they do believe it, they don't care. As long as they get their Supreme Court justices and they get their tax break and they get to make money in the stock. I mean, the stock market's rigged now.
Yeah.
You know, everything is rigged. So as long as they're getting what they want, they don't care who's running the show. And look, let's face it, they're not black. And they're not Jewish, and they're probably not gay.
And so they don't care. But, yeah. Man, your thing about the Supreme Court is terrifically scary, man.
Yep.
To have these kind of people for the rest of their life on there is, I never realized how important that was, and thank God for Ginsburg.
I know.
And the females that are on there.
Yep.
Because the two latest, who knows? But it doesn't look good. And they're really into appointing new judges and making sure that they're all very conservative.
Yeah,
so,
yeah, that's what he did. There's new judges in every state.
Yes. Yes,
it's not just the Supreme Court, you know, federal. It's in every state, so you know.
Yes,
You know, and then he got rid of all of his all of his advisors and stuff when he moved into the White House. He got rid of everybody, and that's a trick that Hitler pulled. You get rid of the people who know what's going on.
Yeah,
and it makes it that much easier to kind of get your wish and will into the mix.
Yeah. Yeah,
you know, and that's what he did. And now he's talking. Yeah. And you know what scared me about Biden is, at first he didn't seem like he had enough muscle to go get into this thing, but he's getting tougher. And let's face it, you have to back him. Doesn't matter.
Yeah,
you don't have to love him at this point. You don't even have to like him. You just have to vote for him.
And it's only for 4 years.
Yes, yes, yes.
And trying to get everything undone and it just seemed like Trump is bent on destroying anything that Obama tried to do, which includes the health care and you name any other thing. And he called Obama the worst president we ever had.
Yeah, yeah.
There is something about his racism and bigotry and it's just so apparent, but it doesn't bother a lot of people. So.
No, it doesn't. But with any luck, the pendulum will swing the other way again. But you have to remember.
I hope so.
You have to remember, even when things were nice and quiet, when Obama was around, these racist guys were still around. You know, they were they were living underground. You know, Trump gave them permission to. Come out of their holes.
Yeah.
But these guys have always been around, and they always will be around, and they'll always be around. And that's scary. That's what's scary. You would think at this point in civilization, you know, people would realize that, what's the point? You're going to have to live together. There's going to come a time when most people walking the earth are going to be brown. They're not going to be Caucasian. They're going to be some shade of brown or black or tan, whatever it is. And, it's like the writing's on the wall. There's like nothing you could do about it. So learn to live with it, embrace it, and make the best of it.
Well, I honestly hope that actually more females get involved. Because I'd like to see them get a chance, because the good old boy system has fucked things up so bad that I just hope that a few females in there, can actually get some things done. And because guys just seem to, if you oppose me, then the only thing to do is get rid of you.
Yes.
Okay?
Start a
there's no other way to have any kind of a dialogue. And again, that premise is pretty scary.
And that's who you're voting for this time. You're voting for Kamala Harris. That's who you're voting for. You're not really voting for Biden. Because he'll step away in 4 years. She'll take over.
Yes.
Yeah.
I hope so. Yeah. I truly do, man.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it's really hard to predict, how things are going to go. And, I've lost a little faith, Elliot, in the American way when I see what's been going on. That reminds me of the early days of the South and the whole discrimination. But it's gone beyond just blacks.
Yes.
Like I said, you could any of the minorities, Jewish, Chinese, name them. God.
Well, it's the Jewish, not Jewish, it's the, it's the Chinese virus.
Yeah.
Keep telling people that it's the Chinese virus and people will start hating Chinese.
Yeah.
you know, it's a rigged game, and he's good at playing it. He knows what he's doing.
Yeah. No. There's a magazine called The New Yorker. I've read articles where, you know, somebody's walking down the street that's Asian, and maybe they can't tell whether it's Japanese or Chinese, and they tell them to go back to China.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's really out there. You're on the subway, you know. What are you doing here? You don't belong in this country, you know.
Yeah,
I mean,
and that's what happened during the Vietnam War.
Yeah.
You know, Bunk, you're older than me, but I was in the village probably when you were. And, you know, I used to go down for all these against the war rallies and all that stuff.
Yeah,
and it was always in the village. It was always, you know, in Washington Square, whatever it was.
Yeah,
and
I
used to get down there a lot. I was young. My my mother was very liberal, and she would make me go down there. And you know, I used to go because it was a day off from school, and I get to hang out in the village.
Yeah.
But you kind of believed in it. You knew. You knew who the good guys and the bad guys were.
So we
went through all that, and I'm sure you guys did. You were living there. And
both the East and the West Village was just a hotbed of activism.
Right. And you lived through it. You were in the service, right?
Yeah.
And your brother was in the service.
Yeah.
So you guys did your time in the service. My dad was in Vietnam in Korea.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, and my father-in-law and my uncles were in World War II, whatever it is. These people, guys like you, guys like them, did the service thing, and they did it for the country. They were proud to be, you know, to do it, and they did what they thought they were supposed to do. They got out. Then we came along, and we kind of fought the system a little, and we got some of the benefits. You know, we got this and we got that. This lunatic took everything away in 3 years.
Yeah.
Took everything back. If I was in the service like you guys were, or the World War II guys, and I saw what was going on in this country now, I would be. I don't know what I would do. I'd be so upset.
Yeah. And I'm telling you, thank God for the GI Bill when I got out.
You know,
I mean that saved so many people.
Right.
And again. There has to be a little focus on education where everybody gets a chance. And again, rather than getting out of college already $100,000 in debt, I don't know how you can survive that kind of shit, man.
Yeah, I don't. Yeah, I had some crazy bills when I got out of college, and it takes forever to pay them off. You're a slave to the system.
Yeah.
That's the new slavery.
Well, maybe that depends on the interest rate, but and maybe I told you I co-signed for my daughter when she was going to school, and it was a federal loan for I think it was $12,000 or $13,000, but 3/4 of the way through, I didn't have enough money to pay it off.
Yeah.
But then I found out, Elliot, that the interest rate was 7.9.
Right.
And I thought, Jesus Christ, that wasn't a good deal at all.
No.
Well.
No, they don't. They don't make your life easy in this country. And
no.
You know, people. You know, I told people that, you know, they tell you to be proud to be an American. I don't know if you're supposed to be proud anymore to be an American. I think you should be happy you're American.
Yeah.
And I think you should be grateful that you live in America. But I think America owes us a little for us to be proud of them. I mean, how many, you know how many years I paid into the system?
You know,
taxes and Social Security and this tax and that tax.
Yeah.
And now that it's time to give back, they don't want to do it.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know?
And I remember Louis Armstrong, they wanted him to go out on tour, you know.
Yeah.
And he said, are you kidding? The way things are here, and I'm supposed to be representing, you know, who we are. He said, fuck you.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, and God, how long ago was that?
Yeah.
But a lot of things basically haven't changed.
Nope,
other
nothing.
Than, you know, some of the Olympic athletes, you know, holding up their, you know, their fists and whatever. It's just been against for the blacks. But again, now it just encompasses so many other you know, minorities, that our reputation is approaching into the toilet in a lot of ways.
We're not allowed to leave the country. Nobody wants us to come visit.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's like, you know, whatever Trump was trying to do, I mean, he isolated us. If that's what he wanted to do, that's what he did.
Yes, yeah.
You know, and that was the Nazi trick, you know.
Yeah,
Just keep your country to yourself. And it's easier to control, and it's easier to keep people where they're supposed to be. I actually have friends, Bunk, that are in the music business that were in big bands. They were in, you know, really, really big, big bands. And these guys want to leave the country. And they're afraid to write to me or to call me and to speak to me because they don't know who's listening in and who's reading their emails and things. And they're afraid they're not going to get passports.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And this is America. I mean, this is, you know, it's really sad. And
well, it's America, but it's a dark America.
Yeah, yeah.
That so many privileges are being eroded.
Yes.
In so many areas that they know who you are, what you're doing, and whatever. It's just. And a lot of people probably aren't even cognizant of some of this stuff.
No.
But there is very little transparency, and the whole secrecy thing has just exploded.
And they brainwash the kids.
Yeah.
They brainwash the kids. When we were young, you didn't want anybody to know where you were, what you were doing, who you were doing it with. Now there's Facebook. I had lunch with this guy today. I did this with that one. I'm going here tomorrow. I'll be here this next week. I'm on vacation for the next 2 days, you know? You're actually telling them what you're doing. And you know, that's without the cameras that are on every block watching you do everything.
Yeah. Well, the whole Facebook thing, and I try and divorce myself from it, but... Yeah. You know, it's...
Well, it doesn't matter. They know what you're doing anyway. I mean, the cameras on your TV that are watching you, and the cameras on your computer watching you. I mean, I'll search for something on Amazon, like a new microphone or something. I'll be getting pop-up ads every place I go for the next year. Based on what I looked at on Amazon.
Yeah.
You know? It's on
and
Facebook.
They're trying to figure out who you are,
yeah.
what your appetite for, and any way that they can sell something once they get enough information on you. And there again, you know, and I keep saying it's scary, but it's gone beyond that point
It's 1984.
Yeah.
You know, it's Orwellian. Yeah. It's Orwellian. Big Brother's watching us. And You know, and if you tell people that, they, you know what? I still want to play my video games. I still want to do FaceTime, so like your camera or my camera could hook up. And, you know, it's just it's not right. It's just the way we're living now. There's just something has to give. I don't know if it's going to be a new civilization. For all you know, this pandemic was meant to cleanse the environment and the population and get rid of, you know, I don't know, you know.
No. Yeah. Well, I know Bonnie said if Trump wins, let's think about moving to Europe.
Yeah.
And, you know, I've since my father was from Italy, you know, I could see my last, you know, days, you know, living in a, you know, a place in Italy or France.
Yeah.
And certainly it's a lot less expensive.
Yeah.
But just to get away from all of this this shit that's been going on.
Well, you better get your passports now because it's not going to get easier.
Yeah. Well, I've always had my passport.
Yeah. I'm just saying, you know, you better have your passports now because... and then you have to hope Italy's going to, you know, let people in from America.
Yeah,
you know,
that is scary.
Yeah, we have the highest, you know, pandemic rate. You know, everybody's, you know, the whole world turned their backs on us, and Trump made sure of that.
Yeah. This, I never expected it to come to this, Elliot, but obviously it has.
And how quick did it happen? It happened overnight.
Yeah, Yeah. And I know that they've said this is probably the most important election in our history, but I certainly feel like it is.
Yes.
And for somebody so incompetent to be able to get to the to be the commander in chief, that in itself, and we're seeing the destruction of so many things.
Right.
It's mind blowing. There's no doubt about it.
Yeah, it is. So, just to change the topic a little, what's going to happen to the music business now?
Well, I told you, it's hard for an artist to look forward to, and I think I told you, Don and I talked about doing a duo at some point next year, going to small venues that
sure.
would be outdoors.
Right.
But it really depends on how much we actually get this pandemic under control. But even at that, Elliot, I don't see a lot of people conforming.
No.
You know, there's so many people now that even if there is a vaccine, they're not going to take it.
No, not going to take it. Because what's his name? Bill Gates is putting transistors in them, right?
But if we don't get it under control, I don't see the music business. Well, as a matter of fact, sports to a certain degree too, it being able to exist.
No,
and I don't know if this country is actually going to be able to get it under control. I don't. When so many people are against government telling them what to do, so. It's going to be a fight all the way.
Yeah, and you know what's scary? I mean, in the 60s and 70s, the musicians led the way.
Yeah.
You know, guys like Dylan, guys like Springsteen, you know, whatever, Crosby,
yeah.
Stills, Nash, and, you know, all those
yeah.
guys, you know, would tell it the younger people what they felt was the right way to go. Nobody's doing
yeah.
that. They're leaving you out to dry now. Nobody's
yeah.
nobody's
yeah.
throwing anybody a life raft, so to speak.
Yeah, yeah.
And
yeah.
that's scary because people, you know, people are confused. You know, a lot of people aren't as politically savvy as you, you know, or me, you know, that really kind of delve into this every day. A lot of people are sitting on their TVs watching the Andy Griffith
yeah.
show.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
you know, watching,
yeah.
you know, whatever. And,
yeah.
They, you know, and they see Trump on the 6 o'clock news and,
yeah.
and they figure, well, this is reality.
Yeah, yeah. There's going to have to be a lot of people that are that have reputations, and that is in the music business.
Yes,
that's in sports and in the entertainment business. Whatever, they're going to have to step up and find some real organic solutions. Otherwise, we're going down.
Yeah,
and that's. And every time
we hit bottom, they pull the bottom out and they make it lower, right?
Yeah.
And that's the scary part. There's no bottom. We just keep getting lower and lower.
I know.
And there's going to come a time if Trump wins again when me talking like this on air is going to, you know.
Yep. You're in trouble.
Yeah. 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 And you're in trouble. And you know what? And at this point in my career, I don't care. But there are a lot younger than me out there who. You know, who have to grow,
of course.
Who have to grow a set of balls and make a stand.
Well, and look at all the people that have come up and stood against Trump.
Yeah.
Man, they've all suffered, you know, a lot of shit.
Yep.
Their way.
Yep.
That you got to be careful now what you say.
Yep. And that's
and enemies are really dealt with pretty harshly.
Yep. And that's why these, you know, this guy told me in a code. And he's from a big band, and he said, "Let's not talk about this. I need a passport. I have to renew my passport."
Yeah, yeah.
And that's pretty scary.
Yeah, yeah. Well, again, getting back to music, it doesn't look good.
No.
At least for the rest of the year here, I don't know what can. And I was talking to Don, you know, I don't even know if they're going to try to have Zappanelli again next year.
Right.
And and that was, you know, the only thing that we had kind of scheduled, but you know, the whole music business, and in more ways than one, is really on life support.
No, it is. I actually do a series of bridal shows every year. It's called Not Your Mother's Bridal Show. That's where the Not Your Mother's tag came from. And we have a drag queen MCs. We do a drag fashion show. It's kind of for alternative couples. It's for the couples that don't want to get married in a, you know, in a tuxedo and white gown. And we were doing pretty well with it. It kind of like supplemented our income, and, you know, it was a lot of work. We did one or two a year, and whatever. I canceled it three times during this pandemic already. You know, I don't know what to reschedule it. And it's just, everybody's hurting now. The hotels are...
Well, so many things, so many areas have suffered.
Yeah.
And
but not
again,
not as much as the entertainment end.
Yes, 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 yeah. Well, again, being a chef, you know, I just know now, some businesses are going to go out of business, and they're not going to be able to make a comeback.
No.
But there's going to have to be some severe changes made. You know, takeout. I don't know.
Yeah.
But it's not only just the restaurant or some of these other areas, especially, you know, the entertainment, music, you name it.
Yeah.
It's really under some heavy duty shit that who knows, you know, what the outcome. But if this virus just keeps hanging around and we don't get a you know, some kind of a lock on it, who knows what's going to happen in the next couple of years? But there's going to be a lot of people out of work, and it's going to take quite a while for the economy to come back.
And people say, okay, a restaurant would have business, no big deal. But that restaurant was feeding a butcher shop. You know, there was a butcher involved. You know, there was a fish market involved. You know, the people working in the restaurant. There's paper people who are selling paper. You know, napkins and
A whole host of people, produce.
Yeah.
You name it.
Yeah, and the same thing with the bands. Okay, a band can't go out, but how about the guys? You know, the concession people who kind of relied on that income. You know, the guys working in these places who picked up money selling, you know, popcorn, whatever the hell it was, you know, liquor. You know, the bars are closed now. This is closed. It's just a rotten. You know, it just goes on and on and on. You know, like branches just go through. And one connects to another, and you know, eventually people won't have money.
Oh, it just keeps going down the line.
Yeah.
One, you know, one area after another. And, you know, my good friend Rusty, who plays with Paul McCartney, you know, they're finished for the year.
Yeah.
And they're talking about it doesn't look good for next year.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
And again, a lot of this is going to depend on how we handle it. But big, small, little, or whatever, it looks very dark.
It does.
In more ways than one.
It does. And we need a hero now. We need somebody to step up and grab the baton and lead everybody through the darkness. Who's it going to be? I'm praying that it's Biden.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, at this point, it's going to have to be if he wins for sure.
Yeah.
But I'm getting my passport ready if he doesn't, because I think the shit is really going to hit the fan with another 4 years of Trump. I do.
Oh yeah, yeah. No, we can't handle four more years of this.
Yeah.
It's just not going to happen. It's, you know, and I don't know. And he has it all planned. I think he wants his daughter to be the first female president. I think that's
well, nothing, Elliot. Nothing would surprise me.
Yeah.
And if you know, if it wasn't for Fox News, just about all of the other stations are critical about Trump.
I know.
So I would think in some way that would be a help, but maybe not. I'm just.
Well, let's hope for the best.
Yeah.
And you know, this pandemic is, I don't know if it's God sent or what. I mean, I'm not a religious guy, but You know, you don't know why it's here. It's here for some reason.
Well, it's nice to have a little hope, you know?
Yeah.
And that's at this point that there's a little left. But, and I hope we just get a little luck besides hope where we can help, you know, turn things around. But it's, you start getting cautious about who you talk to, about what you talk about, and that's not good.
No, that's scary. That's really scary. I've been trying to get a hold of Don. He doesn't answer his phone.
Well, he's not easy to get a hold of sometimes, and he leaves his phone, you know, in places. So I could call him and give him your number.
Yeah, do that, and tell him I want to talk to him like this, and then I want to get the two of you guys back online, the two of you is a lot of fun together. You're a great team. I mean, you guys have been buddies for a long time working partners.
55 years.
55 years. Yeah, that's longer than most weddings, most of marriages now, right?
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
Yeah. And, okay.
But So what are your plans now? Do you have any like short term plans during all of this stuff? You're gonna take some time off. You're gonna relax. There's only so much relaxing you can do.
Yeah. No, I have absolutely no plans at all, other than, like I said, Don called and said, "Let's get together and play some tennis."
Okay.
I try in the course of the day to sit down at the piano and get, you know, a little involved in music in general.
Uh-huh.
Other than that, then I'm watching the news to see what's going on and who's getting arrested and whatever.
Yeah. MSNBC, huh?
Yes.
Yeah,
and CNN.
Yes.
Yeah. So, it's hard to have any plans other than calling up some friends and saying, let's get together, potluck, or we'll cook, or whatever.
Cool.
So, that's just been our agenda of, friends and family. So, that's very necessary to be able to be thankful of what you have.
Yeah.
And I need that acknowledgement on a daily basis that we are so lucky in more ways than one.
Oh yeah, your family in the neighborhood too, right?
Yeah.
That's really good. I do too.
Yeah.
I mean, I have people living with me, and my daughter lives 15 minutes from here.
Mm-hmm.
We don't see her as much as we did, but she comes over on weekends and stuff, and
it's a joy to have that.
Yeah.
And maybe the older you get, the more you acknowledge how lucky you are to have that, because so many people have nothing.
I know.
And it's great to have and it keeps growing in some ways in terms of the family and friends, but I have to say thank you, on a daily basis.
Sure. I know you and Don want to go out alone, but if this thing, let's say there's a miraculous cure, at the end of the year, would you put together a smaller, a little larger unit to go on the road?
Oh, sure. Well, no, we would do our normal quartet.
Uh-huh.
Unfortunately, Elliot, we haven't had a booking agency or a manager in so long, but our names are still out there. This is especially, for Europe. It's very possible that we could do a European tour. So I'm not going to count that out.
Yeah, I forgot who was telling me that you guys did a tour. I don't remember, but you guys were in Europe. I think you and Don were on the bill with them. I don't remember who it was. I know it was a Zappa tribute band, and who was the? Tom Fowler.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Tom got in trouble, he told me. He was he took a bet, and he won the bet, and the promoter didn't pay you guys?
Oh, I don't remember that, but it's Banned from Utopia.
Yeah, Banned from Utopia, yeah.
Yeah,
and yeah, he said he won a bet, and the promoter got pissed, and he wouldn't pay you guys because he won the bet.
Oh, I don't know about that, but I know the sax player with the band had a heart attack and got paralyzed on one side.
Yeah,
and hasn't been able to make a recovery. I don't know, but again, you've got to have somebody hyping you.
Yeah,
trying to get work.
Well,
but
listen to me. You guys have a million fans out there. I know. Whenever I talk to anybody, if I tell somebody that I'm talking to you or to some of the other Zappa guys, people are up and listening. So there's definitely you definitely have people out there waiting for you.
Oh, I know. And when every year that we did play Zappanale, I mean, you can't walk 10 feet without somebody getting an autograph, taking a picture, and telling you how much they enjoyed Frank's music and the band and all that. So, that's really very gratifying too.
And you know what else too? What I notice as Frank, he hasn't been around for a long time now. But people are starting to appreciate the other guys in the band. You know what I mean? It was always Frank. He's out of the picture now. And a lot of people are going back and listening to the music and saying, hey, that was a great band, with and without him.
Well, besides that, Elliot, those people come back with their kids.
Yes.
And listening to a lot of the same music and whatever, so it's generational. It just continues. But that's a real European trait, more so. And it's the same thing with the Beefheart fans, especially in England. So that stuff, it just keeps on, going.
You guys were close with the Beefheart fan, with the Beefheart band, right?
Oh, sure. And we were doing some of the same recording of Scoutman, Troutman replica.
Yeah.
I bought Beefheart's bass clarinet, which I still have.
Wow.
So. That was the good old days again,
I've been talking to John French.
Yes.
And he's going to come on the show. He's doing a Magic Band album, he told me.
Uh-huh.
That should be done soon, he said, and he'd like to come on after that. But he was a hard character to dig up. He said to me, look, I'm a hermit. I don't want to deal with you.
Yeah,
and I said, "Come on, you have to," and blah blah blah. And I finally bugged him enough. We said, "Okay, I'll do it. Let me finish this up." And
But he's a good guy.
Yeah, he is a good
guy. I've talked to him several times.
Yeah,
We've done a few things together. So, but it's unless you have somebody working for you on your behalf. To have to, be able to get up and drum up business, and again, this year is shot.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's really hard.
So who's in the quartet besides you two?
Well, we have our drummer Chris Garcia, who's been with us for years, really great, and we have a few different bass players. That we've been using, but that's kind of up in the air as far as you can't really start talking unless you have something that's coming up
in
terms of work. So we're basically a trio at this point, but we have certainly a few friends who play bass that would be able to go out with us if we got some work. So we'll just have to kind of wait and see that. So, I will call Don.
Yeah.
I'll give him your phone number and have him contact you so you can set something up. And maybe in the near future we can do a kind of a duo thing again.
Well, I want you to do another solo with me, too, as we get closer to the election, okay?
Okay.
We'll get on the phone and we'll bitch a little more, okay?
Yeah, great.
So, listen, stay safe and do what you have to do. And, send my regards to Bonnie and the family, and I'll speak to you real soon, okay?
Yeah, and I'll make sure that Don gets back to you in the next day or so.
Yeah, don't worry about that. And thank you. Your photo's hanging on my wall.
The album. Okay.
I got two, actually. No, both of them are hanging on the wall, just you and the band, and I appreciate that. It's on my studio wall, and... tell Don he owes me a photo, too. He copped out on that, but it's okay.
Okay. I'll do that, Elliot.
Okay, my friend. Stay safe. And
great talking to you, man.
You too, and hope for the best.
You too.
Okay.
Great, thanks.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Okay, guys, and that was Bunk Gardner. It's a pleasure speaking to Bunk again. What a great, great, great guy. And I'm going to play a tune now. I really wasn't going to play any music tonight, but... listen to the horns on this one. This is from Uncle Meat. And here we go. And that was the Mothers of Invention and Mr. Green Jeans. I'm going to play one more from that album. Bunk was so hot on this album. And then maybe we'll call it a night. We'll see. Here we go.
Bunch for me.
Try to find a reason.
song. Out on my Lisa, she's so divine. Helps me stealing up caps, waste all time. Fuzzy dies, bubbles in the black. My little bubbles is ready for a time. Primer, Picarucha, Chevy 39. Going to El Monte, Legion Stadium. Pick up on my Lisa, she's so divine. Helps me stealing up caps, waste all time. Fuzzy dies, bongos in the glass. My ship of love, ready to attack. Won't you please hear my plea?
Primer, Picarucha, Cherry 39. Driving to El Monte, Lincoln Stadium. Pick up on my Lisa, she's only mine.
Not Your Mother's Radio is listener-funded. To contribute and help keep the station going, funds can be sent via PayPal to Elliot. Is Not Your Mother at gmail.com. Remember, there is one L in Elliot. Thank you for your assistance.